Welcome, everybody. Couple of things really quickly before we dive into God's Word. First and foremost, giving this morning. We want to pray for our offering this morning. There's ways to give on the screen behind me. If you are a guest here, this is one of your first times, you don't maybe at this point consider this your church home. Please, this is just for our church family. Just want you to know that. But there are a variety of ways that you can give. Sometimes you give in advance of coming on Sunday. Sometimes it's after. We know there's a lot of different ways to give. But we always want to acknowledge giving as an important part of our worship and what we do in our response, heart response to God. So we're going to pray for our offering. But I also want to mention that after the service, there's going to be about a two-minute break right at the end of the service. That is for those of you who might need to leave. But you hopefully receive communication from us this week regarding a congregational meeting. It sounds really serious. It's not. It's just having to do an opportunity for about a 15-minute window. Jeff Smith is going to give a bit of a presentation to you all as a campus. We have been approved by Harvest to move forward with basically putting in front of you as a congregation an opportunity to do a special giving, special offering, not happening this Sunday, but we want to introduce it to you regarding the facilities and some of the things that we need to finish off here in order for us to relaunch our campus. So if you can stick around, that would be great to be able to hear that presentation. And then in a couple of weeks from now, we'll have the opportunity actually to contribute towards that and making that happen. So let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for this morning. We thank you that we can give in so many ways, Lord. Certainly financially, we see that on the screen, Lord. But there's so many other ways we give as well. And we want to give of ourselves in all areas, Lord. And in this area of giving, financially, Lord, we're just grateful that we can be a part of that, Lord, that we can serve you in this way. Lord, we do pray, Lord Jesus, that you would get the glory through our giving this morning, through our offerings that we bring to you. Lord, we just ask that you would use these for the advancement of your kingdom, Lord, for the great work that you're doing here and also throughout the world. And so, Jesus, we also would ask that as we open up your word this morning, as we talk about prayer, again, in this series called Ask, Lord, that you would challenge and encourage our hearts as well, for we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, I don't know if you've ever wondered what it would be like if you received, if God decided, for example, to put in voicemail. Can you imagine that? I mean, have you ever wondered what it would be like if God decided to simply say, you know what, there's so many calls coming in, I'm going to have to put in voicemail. It goes something like this, maybe. Thank you for calling heaven. For English, press 1. For Spanish, press 2. For all other languages, press 3. Please select one of the following options. Press 1 for prayer requests. Press 2 for thanksgiving. For 3, for complaints, press 3. Press 4 for all other things. I'm sorry. All of our angels are busy helping other sinners right now. However, your prayer is important to us, and we will answer it in the order in which it was received. Please stay on the line. If you would like to speak to the Father, press 1. Jesus, press 2. The Holy Spirit, press 3. Okay, there's some really bad theology going on in here, for sure. To find a loved one who has been assigned to heaven, press 5. Then enter his social security number, followed by the pound sign. If you receive a negative response, please hang up and dial area code 666. Ouch. For reservations to heaven, please enter John, followed by the numbers 316. For answers to nagging questions about dinosaurs, life end, and other planets, please wait until you arrive in heaven for the specifics. Our computers show that you've already been prayed for today. Please hang up and call back tomorrow. The office is now closed for the weekend to observe a religious holiday. If you are calling after hours and need emergency assistance, please contact your local pastor. Thank you, and have a heavenly day. Well, thank goodness that God didn't install voicemail, right? We would all be in dire straits for sure. Thankfully, actually, we all have a direct line of communication 24/7, 365 with God. His line is never busy. He never puts us on hold. He never steps out or goes to the out of the office. He's always there. And through prayer, he's always within our reach. From Jesus' teaching, in fact, in Matthew chapter 6, we've seen this. Last week in part one of this message series that we're in, part one of Matthew 6, what we call the Lord's Prayer typically, or as Pastor Jeff Buckner refers to it, I think, is the disciples' prayer. I call it the prayer of Jesus. It's the exact same prayer that Jesus gave when he instructed his disciples on how to pray. He said, in terms of that direct lifeline to the Father, to God in prayer, here it is. Here's how you should pray. As noted last week, the Lord's Prayer is really a model for us to use. Certainly you can just simply recite the Lord's Prayer, but it makes very little sense to recite the prayer if you don't understand the prayer itself and what each component of the prayer refers to. But I also think it's not only a great prayer to recite, of course, but it's also used as a model for expanding and growing your prayer life, for deepening your prayer life. And in last week's message, what we did is we looked at the prayer and broke it into two sections. The first three components of prayer, and this week will be the last three components of prayer that Jesus gives us in that prayer. And mentioned last week that these two different sections are actually evenly divided in the sense that the first section, the first three components, dealt really fully with the glory of God. That was the focal point of those first three components. Again, think about the Lord's Prayer in this regard. Just if you have your Bible open to Matthew chapter 6, starting in verse 9, I want you to see this. The first three components, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And then notice the shift. That was last week. Notice the shift or the pivot in the prayer starting in verse 11 down to 13. You see, first of all, it's the focus upon God, all upon God, your kingdom. He's our Father, your name, your kingdom, your will. And now beginning in verse 11, give us our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one. You see the distinction that's being made by Jesus. And last week when we talked about this prayer, we said how interesting it is that Jesus set it up this way. It's so easy and it's not sinful and it's not wrong to jump right into request and say, Father, I need this. But what Jesus has done in constructing this prayer for us to pray is he's put us dispositionally in the right place so that when we finally come to the place where we say, Father, give us our daily bread, there's certain things that we have moved through in prayer that positions our heart's posture to be in the right place for asking. We've spoken to the Father all about our personal relationship with him. We've spent time praising him, that is, hallowing his name. We've spent time turning over our priorities, purposes, and plans, surrendering and submitting those to his. So we want his kingdom to be done and his will to be done. And once we've done that dispositionally, we can be in typically a better posture for prayer. Now I'm ready, perhaps in my heart, to ask and ask more rightly. Now I'm in a disposition in my heart to forgive, perhaps more easily. And now I'm in a disposition as well in my heart to deal with the temptations that come. It's almost as if Jesus knew what he was doing. Of course he did. So what we're going to do this morning is we're going to walk through this second half of the Lord's Prayer. Last week focused on the glory of God, and this week really is the focus upon our own lives, our lives, our needs, and the needs of others. And there are here three principles that I want to share with you and pass on to you. But we start with principle four because last week we had one, two, and three. So how do you pray according to Jesus? Principle number four is this. Prayer consists of asking the Father for his provision. Now, if you remember last week, I'm kind of, I like to have what do you call alliteration, you know, so everything starts with a P, right? We had personal relationship last week. We had praise. We had purpose, plans, and priorities. This week, we begin in number four with provision. you can expect two more P's, okay? So if you're ahead of me in the notes, which I know that if I'm listening to a guy preach, I like to be ahead of the person in the notes and fill in ahead of time because I think that I'm kind of ahead of the guy and I know what I'm doing. And then I have to scratch it out because I got it all wrong. So, but there will be some more P's to follow. So Jesus tells us, though, in verse 11, that prayer consists of asking the Father for his provision. It's a simple statement. He says, give us today our daily bread. Give us today our daily bread. Now, one man clearly misunderstood this simple statement of Jesus. The story is told of this man who went to church and he prays, God, I need a break. I need to win the state lottery. I'm counting on you. Having not won the lottery, the man returned to the church a week later and once again praised God about that state lottery. I've been kind to my wife. I've given up drinking. I've been really good. I mean, give me a break. Let me win the lottery. A week later, still no richer, he turns to pray once again. God, I don't seem to be getting through to you on this state lottery thing. I've been using positive self-talk, saying affirmations, visualizing the money. Give me a break. God, let me win the lottery. Suddenly, the heavens opened up. White light and heavenly music flooded into the church, and a deep voice came forth and said, my son, give me a break. Buy a lottery ticket. You're all thinking, how in the world does this fit in with this point? Well, see, here's a man who really clearly doesn't understand what it is when Jesus said, give us this day or today our daily bread. You see, Jesus isn't about us praying for our wants and our greeds. He's all about us praying for our needs. In the book entitled The Prayer of Jesus, Hank Hanegraaff said this comment. He said, In the petition, give us today our daily bread, we pray for all things belonging to and necessary for the sustenance of the body and life. I want you to note very carefully the word necessary. God gives us that which is necessary, not always the niceties of life. He provides for our needs, not our greeds. Our needs and not our greeds. In a similar way, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, years ago, in his great study in the Sermon on the Mount, he said this about this passage. He said, in other words, all we are to ask for is sufficient or what is necessary for each day. It is a prayer for necessities. Bread is the staff of life, and I agree with those who say it should not be confined to the matter of food. It is meant to cover all our material needs, everything that is necessary for the life of man in this world. It must be emphasized, of course, that all we pray for must be absolute necessities. We are not told to pray for luxuries or superabundance, nor are we promised such things. In a similar way, John Stott also, as you can see, sort of how so many will lean in and say, this is what this text really means. You see, Jesus isn't just simply saying, pray for bread. We recognize that. He's using bread to talk about the sustenance of life, the things that are necessary. And John Stott put it this way, Luther had the wisdom to see that bread was a symbol for everything necessary for the preservation of this life, like food, a healthy body, good weather, house, home, wife, children, and good government and peace. And probably we should add that by that bread, Jesus meant the necessities rather than the luxuries of life. You see, over and over again, commentators and scholars will recognize that this passage, what it really is referring to, is Jesus telling us that when we pray, we bring those needs before him, those needs of necessity, we bring them before him. And we live in a challenging time, don't we? I mean, we are really living in, if you look at the world around us, or you look at our own context here where we live, and if you compare us to a place like Haiti, for example, where there are literally those who are actually praying this verse literally, Lord, I need bread. I need a handful of rice. That is such a stark contrast to our situation, isn't it? I mean, I can't tell you the last time I would have ever prayed. I don't think in my life I've ever prayed for a loaf of bread or for a handful of rice. I've never been in a situation like that. There's always been a lifeline. There's always been a credit card. There's always been friends or family or neighbor or somebody. There's always been that. So how does this text even really relate to and apply to us when it says, give us today our daily bread? Well, the reality is that, yes, we don't live in Haiti, but we live in a world that is super expensive, don't we? And it's, in the last few years, gotten worse, as we all know. The things that we consider maybe necessities, even housing, has become so inflated and high. Groceries have become so expensive. People are stretched financially. The cost of your home, the mortgage rate that you have, the expense on your car, the things that if you didn't have them, what would you have? You couldn't have a car, you wouldn't be able to drive. We live in a different kind of situation altogether. So how does this text apply? Well, I think we do face a unique challenge for us as followers of Jesus today, because we may not always think of ourselves this way, but our problem is actually affluence more, isn't it? It's affluence. And so in an affluent society, an affluent context, how do we think about this text, give us today our daily bread? I want you to turn, if you want, for a moment to Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 7 through 18. A passage that actually really speaks powerfully to this issue of affluence, starting in verse 7 of Deuteronomy chapter 8. It says, "For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and springs flowing out in the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of olive trees and honey." Verse 9, "a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity." Interesting comment there, isn't it? Give us this day our daily bread. And yet God was bringing the nation of Israel into a land where they would not have a lack, in which you lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and out of whose hills you can dig copper. "And you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land that he's given to you." Friends, this is our land. Is this not a description in many respects, recognizing that this isn't really directly at us? It was written to the Israelites in their entrance into the promised land, but it really in many ways parallels us, doesn't it? Notice the word, though, that's given in here. "Take care lest you forget the Lord your God by not keeping his commandments and his rules and his statutes, which I command you today. Lest when you have eaten and are full and have built good houses and live in them, and when your herds and flocks multiply and your silver and gold is multiplied and all that you have is multiplied, then your heart be lifted up and you forget the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, who led you through the great and terrifying wilderness with its fiery serpents and scorpions and thirsty ground where there was no water, who brought you water out of the flinty rock, who fed you in the wilderness with manna that your fathers did not know, that he might humble you and test you to do good, you good in the end. But beware lest you say in your heart, 'My power and the might of my hand have gotten me this wealth.'" This passage is really a passage that speaks to the affluence of our age. You know, somebody in Haiti wouldn't read this passage as we would read it today, would they? Or in another poverty-stricken country. We live in the North Shore in particular, in a very affluent society. We may still struggle at times to pay our bills, but in comparison, we have great affluence. But I think what this text in Deuteronomy does is it speaks to a couple of things. It tells us that affluence can actually cause us to forget God, which is a tragic thing. We get into the land, we enjoy all of the good things, we experience affluence, and it's easy to forget. It causes us to say that I did it, I worked for it, I made it happen, I did it because I'm the one who's successful. And the reality is, actually, the only reason you and I have what we have is purely by the grace of God and his mercy, that for some reason he has chosen us to live where we live at the time in which we live. And yes, you can say that you've worked hard. And yes, you can say that you brought all your skills and abilities. But the reality is we always back the truck up a little bit beyond that and say, listen, where did you think you got those from? You got them directly from God Almighty himself. And it also tells us, secondly, that affluence can create in us a lack of dependence upon God. I mean, if I have all the bread that I need, why would I need to trust in God? If I have all the props and everything around me that I can sort of lean on, I have so many props that I can lean on before I ever have to lean on God. You see, Jesus' prayer seems to sort of strike a challenge for us in this regard, doesn't it? For us who are so affluent, we would be well to remember the words of Martin Lloyd-Jones, who said this. He said, "We must all realize our utter dependence on God, even for our daily bread. If God willed it so, we should have no daily bread. He could withhold the sun and its influence. He could stop the rain. He could make our land absolutely barren so that the farmer, with all his modern implements and chemicals, could not raise a crop. He could blast the crop if he wanted to. We are absolutely in the hand of God, and the supreme folly of this 20th century is the folly of thinking that because we have acquired a certain amount of knowledge of the laws of God, we are independent of him. We cannot live for a day without him. Nothing would continue were it not sustained and kept going by God. Give us this day our daily bread. It is a good thing for us at least once a day, but the oftener the better, to remind ourselves that our times, our health, and our very existence are in his hands. Our food and all the necessary things come from him, and we depend upon his grace and mercy for them." That's the reminder for us as we look at this text, as those who really, for the most part, really experience significant affluence. Perhaps a good prayer for us is this one, found in Proverbs chapter 30, verses 7 through 9. "Two things I ask of you, O Lord. Do not refuse me before I die. Keep falsehood and lies far from me. Give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise, I may have too much and disown you and say, 'Who is the Lord?' Or I may become poor and steal and so dishonor the name of my God." You see the heart of this prayer, don't you? Having just sort of reflected upon Deuteronomy 8 and the significant heartache and challenge of poverty, but also what happens as a result sometimes of those who have great riches, there's a challenge, significant challenge with both. And he's saying, give me neither. I don't want to have so much riches that I might find myself not dependent upon you, not trusting in you, thinking that I did it, that I'm a self-made individual, and neither do I want to have poverty. Who would want to have that? I don't want to have too much and disown you. I don't want to be so poor that I steal and dishonor you. God, don't give me too much and don't give me too little. Give me what I need. My daily bread. Give me only my daily bread. Now, I'm not suggesting here this morning that we go and sell all that we have and that we just sort of like live like hermits or something like that. That's not my point in this at all. It's simply to tell us that when we're looking at this prayer, how do we actually pray this in the culture in which we live today? And I would suggest, first of all, that we live in a really expensive time, and some of us have a great abundance and some of us have less abundance, don't we? And it is a challenge to still pay, and we have genuine needs, and those needs are not always simply just monetary either. So when he talks about praying for daily bread, he's not just talking about literal bread. Certainly that might be true more for a Haitian. He's not talking about bread. He's talking about bread in a broader picture, the necessities of life, all of those sort of things. And under that category, certainly financial things fit there, but there's a whole lot of other needs that we have as well. This is a prayer broadly, I believe, that Jesus is saying there are needs that you and I have that we cannot meet even financially in our lives, because the needs are not related to financial issues at all. You can't pay your bills. It's a challenge because the mortgage is too high. You're caught off guard with medical expenses. You're wondering how you're going to take care of your kids. You're wondering, in that sense, how you're going to be able to survive. You think, well, how can this be? I make this much income, but there's no income left because it's all gone to this. And so you still find yourself praying for these kind of needs as well financially. I would suggest that when we're praying for our daily bread, though, that there are several things that we should probably do. And these are in your notes. And we're going to kind of fly over these because some of them are kind of embedded right in the same sort of general vicinity of this text in the Lord's Prayer in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5 through 7. And Jesus talks about prayer and dependence and bread in different texts. So, for example, when praying for daily bread, we should first of all pray and do not worry. Right, Jesus said, we sang a great song about that this morning. We should pray and we should not worry. He knows, according to Matthew chapter 6, 25 to 33, he knows all of your needs before you even ask. He knows you bring before him. He is the one, our Father in heaven, who knows what you need. So not worry about what you will eat or what you will drink or what you will wear. Are not these the things that the pagans run after? Yeah, they are. But instead, seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. In other words, he's going to give you what you need. And anyway, again, to make that distinction between the needs and the greeds, the needs and the greeds. I remember reading one author, I was reading it just to critique his book, actually. And I remember him talking about him and his wife standing. They were out for a walk one night evening, and they came to this neighborhood, and they looked at this home, and they said, she was like, I would love to have a home like that someday. And he was like, you can't, you know, we can never afford a home like that. And she said, well, I'm going to believe God for this home. They ended up getting the home. And I look at that and I think to myself, so you have a perfectly fine home right now, but you're going to get in front of this home. And you come at this perspective later in the book that you say, I'm a child of the King, therefore I deserve this. I deserve this. You see, all that is the prosperity gospel making its ugly way into the life of the church, right? Like, instead of being satisfied with the home that you have, you now are going to say, no, I need this bigger home, this better home. That's what I need. And then you start to justify it biblically somehow that, you know, Lord, give us this day our daily bread. I'm sorry, but that's not your daily bread. It's just not. But we're called to pray and to not worry. Do not be anxious about your life, what you'll eat or what you'll drink or what you wear. I have to deal with this. I suspect you do too. Even though sometimes I look at income and I think, Lord, I don't understand. Where's it all going all the time? And I think, well, I got four kids. They're not all taking the money anymore. But it definitely does go to them sometimes. But you're like, that's it. We're going to reclaim our funds from our children. Nobody gets any more money. We're cutting y'all off. But sometimes, you know, you do worry, right? And you do stress and you do anxious. You know, you're balancing your books and you're trying to figure it all out. And you think, but Lord, how can it be when you make this much in a culture in which you live? But then Scripture still speaks to us. Don't worry. Don't be anxious. Scripture also says, pray and do not give up. So when you and I are praying and we're bringing our request to God, we're asking for his provision, we don't just pray once. We pray and we don't give up. The very first sermon in this series in Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 through 11, Jesus said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and the door will be opened. Literally in the Greek New Testament, it's keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. There's persistence in prayer then. It's not like I asked once. It's ask, keep on asking, repeatedly ask. Jesus even instructed us with this in Luke chapter 18 when he talked about the prayer of the persistent widow. She continued to come and she continued to knock at the door. Like, I need bread, I need bread, and I need bread. And it was in the middle of the night and finally, you know, she wore the judge out or whatever and she gets the door open. She gets what she needs. It was Jesus' illustration to say, don't ever give up, keep on praying. You know, it's interesting that Jesus tells us to do that, right? He recognizes when he tells us that, he recognizes that there are times that you're going to need to persist. So endure in prayer, persevere, keep on asking. And then thirdly, pray and trust in God's goodness. We have a good Father, don't we? We've heard that in this series as well. If your Father knows how to give good things to you, though you're evil, will he not give much more? Will your Heavenly Father give you much more? He is a good Father. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father, James tells us in chapter 1. We also should pray confidently. And I want us all to turn in the Bible to this. And you know, frankly, there's so many things in Scripture about this that we could have this series that would go on for a much longer time. But I want you to turn to Mark chapter 11 for a minute as we talk about praying confidently. You know, you and I, when we pray, we're asking God for his provision. What are we doing? We're standing on the will of God. That's what we do. We stand on the will of God. We stand on the authority of Scripture. Somebody say, well, how do you know it's God's will to provide daily bread? Because he said that he would provide daily bread. So when he says something, it's a promise of God. We cling to that, and we pray that, and we believe by faith. And this is, quite frankly, when you think about the health and wealth gospel, the name it and claim it teachers, there's an element, there's a smidgen of truth that they have that is actually twisted and exploited. And as a result of that, they cause sometimes Christians to overreact, and so we don't even think about and talk about faith and praying. But if God has promised something, then what should we do with the promise? We should hold on to the promise, and we should pray believing prayers that we are going to receive the thing that we ask for. Now, that gets abused by all kinds of people. It does. Well, I'm going to believe for that new home. I'm going to believe for that, you know, that Audi 5000 or whatever it is out there today. Right? I'm going to believe for, like, you could ask for a million different things that you'd say, well, you know what? That's not what he's talking about, though. Where in Scripture did he ever promise those kind of things? But so, for example, when I think about the salvation of children, if you have lost loved ones in your home, is it God's will that your child would hear the gospel and be saved? Or you think about the growth of his church. You think, is it God's will that his church would grow, that people would come to know Jesus Christ? Well, I don't know if I want to pray confidently about that. Well, you should, right? We should pray confidently about that. We should be going forward and saying, it is God's will, we know it is, for his kingdom to grow. So why would we shrink back and not have faith and pray about that? So what I'm saying to you is, you know what Scripture says about the promises of God, you line yourself up with the promises, and you pray in faith, believing that you've already received them. That is not the health and wealth gospel, because what this does is it hunkers down in what God has actually promised. You're simply saying, God, you promised this in your word. So here it is, in Mark chapter 11. Mark chapter 11, starting in verse 20. As they passed by in the morning, they saw the fig tree withered away to its roots. And Peter remembered and said to him, Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed has withered. Now, just to stop on this for a moment, if you look back just a few verses later, it's the day before, and Jesus curses the fig tree. How does he curse the fig tree? He actually speaks to the fig tree. He actually curses. He commands the fig tree. He actually talks to the fig tree. Okay? It's interesting. It's an interesting point. And now notice what he says to his disciples. So they see that, yes, what Jesus spoke to the fig tree actually happened, and they said, Jesus, look, it's withered. Verse 22, Jesus answered, have faith in God. Truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him. So if you think about it, what's Jesus just said to do? He's just said to say to the mountain. How do you speak to the mountain? Well, Jesus just finished speaking to the fig tree, didn't he? He actually spoke to the fig tree. He cursed the fig tree. Here he says to you, whatever the mountain is, whatever it might be that's actually his will, you speak to that thing. Now, I can't tell you how many times I've heard people that just avoid this text. They avoid it because they don't want to sound like a health and wealth gospel person. Because there are elements in here that this text in particular have been exploited by that particular group. And as a result of that, we become reactionary. But Scripture calls us to faith. It calls us to praying in faith. And it calls us to praying in faith, believing when the thing that we are praying for is actually biblical and scriptural, we stand in the authority of God's word and we pray it. Right? So that's sort of the posture, I think, of prayer here. So he says in verse 23, truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up, thrown into the sea, does not doubt in his heart, believes what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it and it will be yours. Now that phrase, whatever you ask for in prayer, that is the phrase that has been manipulated and abused by people. They see whatever as this broad, all-encompassing category that you could ask for absolutely whatever you want, and God will give it to you because you're a child of the King. That is not a biblical viewpoint of this text. The words whatever are defined by the context. In 1 John chapter 5, for example, verse 14 and 15, he says, whatever you ask for in prayer, according to the will of God, according to the will of God. You and I, we pray how? We pray according to the will of God. So whatever you pray for that's according to the will of God, you will receive it. So we go forward in faith, not in defeat. The starting point for us shouldn't be doubt and defeat. It actually should be one of faith. Jesus always encouraged people to believe, to have faith. Now, certainly Jesus also did things where people had little faith, they had weak faith, they doubted, they had no capacity for faith. Jesus still can do whatever he wants to do. There's no doubt about it. And yet, at the same time, does he not call us to have faith? He said, in fact, in just text, in Mark chapter 11, it's in the command, it's an imperative in Greek, have faith in God. It's a command. Have faith in God. That faith in God is not some sort of magical formula that I utilize to get what I need or to get what I want. Rather, it is faith in the person of God, his power, knowing who he is, that he actually can do it. He can accomplish it when I can't and nobody else possibly can. That's what it is. So when we're praying for our daily bread, this is the context, I think, in which Jesus is saying that. You and I pray and we don't worry. We pray and we don't give up. We pray and recognize God's goodness. And we pray confidently with faith, saying, Lord, I know that you have said this is your will. And when we don't know God's will, we back up. We back up. And we humbly surrender that to the Lord. Lord, if this is your will, I don't know if this is your will, Lord, but I'm just going to bring this before you. I'm going to bring this before you. Not my will, but your will be done. So that's principle number four. Principle number five is this, that prayer consists of asking the Father for pardon. Asking the Father for pardon. Now, I want to remind you that last week when we were talking about the Lord's Prayer, the prayer of Jesus, I'm talking about this as being a model, that each of these components of prayer, really, if you, I encourage you to think about each component like a concentric circle. So when you're praying, for example, about God's provision in your life. Principle number four, think about concentric circles. Think about starting with maybe yourself before God. God, I have these needs. I got to bring them to you. I have these needs. But then you move outward to the next circle. And you, Lord, I know my spouse has needs, specific needs that they don't even know they have maybe, and I'm going to pray for those. And you move outward. Lord, my kids have needs, right? You see? And you move out from that, and you're like, my broader family, or now my church family, people I know in my church family that have these needs that I'm aware of, Lord. And boy, there's these needs, and you continue to move out. You see, you can move out from this center point all the way out to your community and to the world, right? You can move it. Can you imagine what your prayer life, how much time you could spend in prayer if you just sort of expanded that with concentric circles? If you stick to just your own needs, there's nothing wrong with that. I'm just simply saying, in terms of a model, and you and I utilizing this as a model, this is a way for us to think about growing and developing our prayer life. So you can do that right from the very, very beginning, like with Our Father, making it personal. You can spend time on that, hallowing his name, Lord. You can start, like we talked last week, with a center, like, Lord, I'm not hallowing your name enough. Help me to do that more. Move out, move out, move out, move out. You can do it with the next thing, right? The will of God and the kingdom of God, Lord, make that true in my life and in my spouse's life and my kid's life and my, I don't see it in here and in our community that doesn't hallow your name and they false worship them. You can move it out and out and out, and you do it in the provision part, right? You move out. And the same thing as we come now to pardon. So prayer consists of asking the Father for pardon. Matthew 6:12, Jesus then said, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. Forgive us our debts. And we all need forgiveness, don't we? We all need mercy and grace. When we sit down to pray and we go to that prayer closet that Jesus described in Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 through 7 in that area, we go to that prayer closet, we should take time to reflect on our sins, shouldn't we? We should say, Lord, I ask that you would help me. And there's sort of five facets of forgiveness I want to kind of bring out to you as we kind of roll through this, just to express to you. Number one is, when you do this, when you get in prayer, ask the Holy Spirit to reveal every sin. We have to actually have time for this, don't we? The Holy Spirit maybe have already revealed things, but the disposition and the posture of spending time with prayer in the Lord, that you get to this point, right, when you spent time with the Father, praising Him, surrendering your will to His will, and now you're going to say, Lord, I see things in me. Reveal more. Psalm 139, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts and see if there be any grievous way in me. When sin is revealed, then what do? Well, secondly, we confess each sin. We need this in our prayers. Confess. John tells us in 1 John 1:9, as we know this text, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In 1 John 2, verse 1, if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is the atoning sacrifice or the propitiation for our sins. That is the one who turns away the wrath that we deserve because of sins, away from us onto Christ. He's there as our advocate before the Father, the text tells us. So we come to Him, Holy Spirit, reveal the sin in me. And Lord, now that You're revealed, I want to confess those things to You. And then thirdly, by faith, we actually have to accept forgiveness. And sometimes we don't do very good at that as believers. We want to beat ourselves up. I can tell you, I do a really good job of beating myself up. My wife can testify to that. But a lot of things, not just sin things. I do a really good job of beating myself up. Why? Because, you know, we have this weird idea in our head that we should be perfect when we know we're not. Well, we'll never be perfect. But for some reason, we still think that we should be. We've got a psychological problem, right? But accepting God's forgiveness by faith. When He says that He's forgiven us, then we need to be able to accept that forgiveness. Psalm 103 tells us that He's taken our sins and He's removed them. He's cast them as far as the east is from the west. Like, they think about that for a moment. I mean, if from where I'm standing right now, if we just went in a straight line east and wherever east is and west, or north and south, I don't know where we are, whichever direction you go, if you're not going around the globe and you go straight out into the universe, you're going to keep going forever. They're never going to, like, it's just gone. And accept that. This is the grace of the gospel in your prayer, washing over you, reminding yourself of the gospel of Jesus Christ in your life, His mercy. And then fourth, when this happens, make restitution with others when necessary. It's sometimes important that God reveals things in our lives. We go, you know what, you were kind of a buckethead, and you need to go fix this. Like, you need to go to that person. You need to acknowledge that you hurt them or that you possibly hurt them, that the Holy Spirit kind of put His finger on you and revealed to you that, boy, maybe you were insensitive or rude or whatever it might be. And restitution sometimes needs to be made. Number five, forgive the debts of others. You know, when you get to a place like this and you and I have received pardon, the natural thing for us then to do, because we've experienced the grace of God, we've gone through this process in prayer, is how can we hold on then to bitterness, resentment, and anger towards others? God is saying at that point, you've got to release that. You've got to turn that over. You've got to hand it over. In fact, Jesus even said this at the end of the prayer of Jesus, at the end of the Lord's Prayer, that if you don't forgive others when they sin against you, your Father in heaven won't forgive you. What's up with that? Well, the reality is if you and I have that kind of a disposition of our heart, what does that say about the grace of God in our lives? You see, it raises a question of whether we've really been impacted by the grace of God in the gospel. It's one thing to struggle with the forgiveness, to arriving at that. It's one thing to do that. But it's another thing altogether to say, you know what? Ain't going to happen. That's another thing altogether. we need to ask God to help us with forgiveness. To say, Lord, move my heart. I've had situations in my life where there was a group of individuals, there was three or four of them that I actually had to get with, and I actually had to forgive. I didn't tell them that, but I had to come to a place because they had hurt me so deeply, wounded me. The pain was so great. And they were unaware of, I think, and thought that they were in the right. And not that they were fully in the right or wrong, but they wouldn't acknowledge or didn't acknowledge a thing. And I knew that I just had to go, and I knew that I had to do the right thing. Because before God, that's what he wanted me to do. You see, that's the kind of stuff that we need to do as followers of Jesus. When we come to prayer, this you can see if you pray this as forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors in sort of a really sort of quick way, reciting it, that's great, you can do that. But I just want to encourage us not to blow past it so fast, not to blow past any of these components of prayer so fast that it becomes mere resuscitation, like we're just reciting something and it's devoid then of actually true meaning to us. It's not to say that you can't have it weighted with meaning and heartfelt when you pray just this prayer alone. You can, but there is a danger in becoming one who just offers vain repetition and babbling, like I know the prayer and I can recite the prayer and not even think about what I'm saying. But this is cause and a model to slow it down and to park on it for a while and use this as a model. You know, there's other models that are used. I mean, they're kind of cute little models. They're not wrong or anything. They're just, you know, the Acts model. Adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. Okay, that's great. But you know, the Jesus model is better. I just think it's just better. It's more comprehensive. I would encourage you to adopt it. Hank Hanegraaff comments on this petition for pardon and forgiveness. What he says is really important. He says, one of the more liberating things that can ever enter the human heart is when you pray this prayer to think in your mind of the one person or the two or three people that you really have an unresolved problem with, and while you cannot coerce anybody to ask for forgiveness, to start praying for that person. If you can learn to pray for those who spitefully abuse you, you'll be the quintessential example of true liberation. You know, it's easy to pray for those that love us, but not so easy to pray for those who spitefully use us. If we can but only learn to forgive and pray for them, we will be set free. What a great comment on that. There's sometimes I have certain people that come back to my own mind, and I think, Lord, have I really forgiven that person? And why do I have sort of this feeling still? And the way to work that out is to say, Lord, please change that in me. Like, take the edge off that. Like, shave that down still. I still see there's some things there that you need to work on for me in my life still. I'm not quite there. And you know, because frankly, people do horrible things to people sometimes, right? Oh, it's sometimes easy to forgive the person that cuts you off in traffic. That's an easier one. But there's horrific people have done horrific things to other people. That's almost hard to fathom how a person could ever forgive. And that's why, in many respects, forgiveness is us putting our foot forward to the Lord, I think, and saying, Lord, grow me in this and change me in this. Because I do know that you don't want me to stay here. There's nothing good about me staying here in bitterness, imprisoning myself. I have to find freedom, Lord. And that leads us to the sixth and final petition or principle in the Lord's Prayer, the prayer of Jesus. It's this. Prayer consists of asking the Father for protection. He ends the prayer this way in verse 13, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. What a great thing to pray. Why would Jesus say to pray this in light of James 1 verse 13, where we're told that God cannot be tempted, nor does he tempt anyone? James tells us that God doesn't tempt anyone, but Jesus says, well, pray, lead us not into temptation. Well, God's not going to lead you in temptation, so why would you bother praying that? Well, part of the reality here is that the word temptation and testing, perasmos in Greek, is the exact same word. You see, temptation and testing are actually really closely related. You think about Jesus when he went into the wilderness. He went into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. But actually, Luke's account tells us in chapter 4, verse 1, that the Holy Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness. That was the Spirit that led him into the wilderness. For what purpose? To be tested. You see, testing and temptation are so related. So, for example, I remember Dr. John Barkman years ago giving this example, my first semester of Bible college in the year 687 B.C. And I remember him saying, you know, it's like this in James. It's like somebody, you're a college student and you don't have any money, and you're walking down your hallway and you see somebody on your dorm floor has their door open and you notice $20 sitting on the count on their desk. And you're like, sheesh, I really need like just a few bucks. Now, you're tested, right? Your testing is that I don't have any money and I need money. You're in a trial. But very quickly, the trial or the test turns into temptation, doesn't it? And you now have a decision to make. Am I going to take or am I going to resist? A lot of temptation comes out of testing. The Lord leads us into testing. He tests us. He led Jesus into the wilderness to be tested. And out of the testing came what? Temptation. He's in the wilderness for 40 days, no eating and no drinking. Out of that emerges temptation. The tempter comes to him. You and I face that same kind of reality. The difference is that Jesus actually completely overcame and showed us actually that you can overcome. And actually in Luke's account, it was the power of the Spirit actually that enabled him to come. It wasn't because he pulled out of his back pocket this God card, which he is, fully God, fully man, while on earth. But he didn't operate out of his divinity at that point to say, you know, I can overcome this because I'm God. He actually, as a man, spirit, a man anointed with the Holy Spirit, Acts 10:38, Luke chapter 4, he actually, through the Spirit, actually had victory over the temptation. He's led into the wilderness by the Spirit, and actually on the other side of it, in verse 13, I think it is, if you look at the text, he's coming out of the other side, and he's strengthened by the Spirit. The Spirit is on Jesus in his ministry, and you and I look at Jesus as a model for this for us to say, when we're dealing with this kind of temptation, we so need the work of the Spirit and the power of the Spirit in our lives. The testings will be there. The temptations will also come. So, Lord, lead us not into temptation. When we go into testing, he will take us there, but he won't lead us into the actual tempting. He won't do the actual tempting is my point, but he will actually allow you to be tested. And when you are facing that temptation, the prayer, though, is, then, Lord, deliver us from the evil one. Help me to be delivered. The point is to be on your guard then, isn't it? It's a prayer for vigilance at the end of this prayer. It's to recognize that you and I are in a war, a holy war, against the devil and all of his demonic host. That this is not just a physical, material existence that we have. We are not just naturalists. We don't have that kind of worldview, but our worldview is actually one where there is behind the scenes in the unseen realm spiritual forces that are at work. And the one is one who doesn't lead us into temptation and who delivers us from the evil one, and the other one is the evil one, and then there's ourselves. And you and I, our battle is with what? It's with the great trinity of evil, the world, the flesh, and the devil. The world that's outside, that's this sort of system that's organized and pitted against God and wants everything to do with dismantling the things of God. It's a system that we live in that's going to constantly pull you and try to draw you in and tempt you and entice you. And then we also battle with our own flesh, our own sinful nature. We are born in this world as sinners, and we are sinful people saved by grace. And then we also have the evil one and his minions who will attack you and me. But thankfully, we're not left alone. We have this unholy, ungodly Trinity, but we have the Trinity, the true Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit, all coming to our aid. We have the Spirit of the living God. We have the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. We have the power of the Spirit in us, as we've seen with Jesus in the temptation. And we have to stand in that strength. And we pray towards that end in this prayer. Jesus, lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one. Why? Because 1 Peter 5, verse 8 tells us that we are to be self-controlled and alert because the enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him. And how do you resist him? Standing firm in the faith. Resist him by standing firm in the faith. Don't go on a witch hunt. Stand firm in your faith. That's how you resist him. Because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. The Apostle Paul reminds us in Ephesians chapter 6 that what we should do in prayer is we should ask God to help us put on the armor. The armor in many respects is about Christian character, isn't it? He says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then with a belt of truth buckled around your waist, with a breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, he says, is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. What an incredible prayer. For you and I to recognize that when we get up in the morning, the battle begins. When the feet hit the floor, before they hit the floor, sometimes it's hard to get them to hit the floor. But when they hit the floor, say, Lord, here I am. Here I am. And I ask you for your protection. As I get going in my day, I pray on the armor. Help me to put on the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, take up the sword of the Spirit. Help me to stand alert. Help me to be on guard. Help me to resist the devil. You see, that's what we need to do. And when we pray for protection, again, if you think of concentric circles in your prayer, certainly that's about you and me. We do that. And then, again, moving outward. Lord, protect my spouse. Protect my kids. Oh, Lord, the warfare that they're under today. Protect and go out and out our church. And churches are being inundated with all kinds of garbage from the secular society, trying to shape and form them to reject the word of God and the authority of God's word. And see, you pray about all this stuff. So daily, that's what we need to do. And there's plenty of room to grow in prayer, isn't there? I know there sure is for me, I find too. We have lots of room to grow in prayer as believers. And so as we wrap this up, this message, in terms of final thoughts for this, I just want to sort of quickly reiterate to you that the model of the Lord's Prayer consists of these six principles for your prayer life. Use this, if you will, as an outline. Make it personal about your relationship with your Father. He is your Abba. Talk to him that way. He's not far and removed. He's in the heavens, literally, in the Greek text. He's, yes, holy and transcendent, but he's also near. That's what a father does. He comes near. Praise, take time hallowing his name. Priorities, surrendered them to the Father. His will be done. His kingdom come. Provision, Lord, give us today our daily bread. Pardon, Father, forgive me for my debts. Protection, Lord, deliver me from the evil one. The six P's of prayer. And now all we have to do is make it happen and pray. Let's pray together. Lord, I give you praise and thanksgiving for who you are. Lord, I am humbled in my own life, Lord, at this prayer. And often when I think about my own prayer life, Lord, and my own need for more of you in prayer, Lord, would you grow us as your people in prayer? Would you grow us, Lord, to be more prayer dependent and focused on you and have your view of things? Lord, would you give us a passion and a hunger and a thirst for your presence to actually want to spend time with you and to bring ourselves before you? We invite you to do this, Lord. We thank you for your Holy Spirit's work in our life. We thank you for the truth of the gospel of Jesus, our Savior. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.